Would you stand with us, please? You may be seated.
Smitty, also known as Smitty, 89 years of age. Sheridan passed away Friday, October 15th, 2021. He was born December 5th, 1931, in Cato, Arkansas, to the late Elijah Oscar and Ella Beasley Smith. He was a member and served as a deacon of Immanuel Baptist Church in Sheridan. He was a retired master sergeant with the United States Air Force during the Korean-Vietnam War. Smitty later worked for the Union Pacific Railroad, Action Realty, and was a former operator of ICO-1 site. He is survived by his wife, 68 years, Pauline Shelnut Smith, two daughters and sons-in-law, Kathy and Elroy Brown, Penny and Bob Tannehill, son and daughter-in-law, Clay and Audrey Smith, five grandchildren, Kevin Murphy, Chad Hinkle, Adam Smith, Heather Martone, and Holly Brown, 12 great-grandchildren, all of Sheridan. He was preceded in death by his parents, three brothers, one sister, and one grandson, Tony Murphy. The family would like to express special thanks to the staff of Crown Point Assisted Living, Kindred Hospice, and his three caregivers for their exceptional care and love. I want to speak on behalf of the grandkids. We grew up in a great situation. We lived on what some call Smith Hill in the backyard, or next to our grandparents. My childhood was amazing. My grandparents made that such an honor that the kids dreamed. We had cousins to play with, land to play sports on, a swimming pool, a two-story house with a balcony, and a music room full of instruments we were not supposed to touch. Papa had a full shop full of stuff to dig through and use. Older I got, I realized my Papa liked to collect junk. Papa and Mama's house was the place to be. I believe my Papa planned it this way. This is what he wanted. He wanted all of his kids and grandkids together living next to each other. This is where he could help influence us, mold us, and guide us, and I'm sure pray for us a lot. See, Papa was the glue to this family. He led by example through his walk with Christ, his love for his family, and his work ethic. Some of my fondest memories were Sunday afternoons. See, you never asked where we were eating after church. It was a given. Everyone would gather at their house, and this is where I heard my Papa pray every single time before lunch. Not some cookie-cutter prayer, but one with compassion and a few big words I did not understand. To us grandkids, he was a big deal. He had a special way to make each of us open up to him and talk. He would make each of us feel like we were the favorites. Adam, we know it's you. When he was talking to us, he would be so interested in our lives. As we got older, great grandkids come along. You saw that love and interest move to them. He would be so in tune and interested in their lives. He was so proud of all of them, and each of them were his favorite. Us grandkids, we took a back seat. One of her fondest memories is when he would pick her up for Sunday school, that was their time, and he played a big part in her salvation. He was committed to having his family in church. See, if you missed a Sunday, the next time he saw you, he would say, "I sure missed you Sunday," or "I didn't get a chance to talk to you Sunday." Him knowing we weren't there, well, next Sunday we would be in church. Holly said, "My most cherished memories with my papa were made in the last 2.5 years while working as his nurse. We would develop a relationship we might not have ever had, and it has been one of the greatest privileges of my life. To all of those he woke up singing to, I paid him back on several occasions, waking him up to Father Alarm. He would just laugh and join right in. The saying that is said most often to bring comfort to those in a time of loss, they are happier now, we're in a better place, I know that's true. It never seemed to help much, though. This loss is different. You see, I've never met a soul who loved and served God more. So my heart smiles because I know his happiness now is truly unimaginable. Thanks, Lord. Adam said one of his greatest memories I have with Papa was when we were working on rental properties or at the service station. We seemed to be in the middle of everything. When it comes to rentals, he taught me if it's a plumbing issue, a little bit of glue is good. The whole bottle is great. We weren't worried about looks. We also made trips to Sam's to buy stock for the service station. We would have his little red truck loaded down. We would be coming over the river bridge, the bumper and hitch dragging, throwing sparks everywhere, Papaw just a-laughing. And the stories I heard from Papaw, Herschel Croy, Harold Epperson, and Eddie Lavelle at the gas station, you wouldn't believe them unless you were there. We had a special bond that I just can't explain. Thanks, everyone. I want to end by saying we were blessed to have him in our lives. He was one of a kind. And to the family, let's not let his legacy diminish. Rather, someone be the glue, and let's continue to build on his memories.
In case y'all don't know, I'm the youngest son. I saw a few faces I don't know. There's been rumors going around that I'm not, but I am the youngest son. And I want to reiterate what Kevin said. On behalf of the family, thank you guys for coming to help us celebrate Dad's life. I also want to thank my two sisters. For the last 7 years, they have put aside their lives to dedicate to Mom and Dad. They've done a good job. I also want to thank my daughter Holly and the staff at Crown Point, Aaron Thrillkill, and the entire staff of Kindred Hospice. The special caregivers, Katie, Shane, Tammy, I see you guys here. Dad had a way of making friends really quick. And I'm pretty sure he was the favorite at the assisted living place with the cook ladies, with everybody. Really exceptional care that he's had. Today I want to give just a little brief history of Dad's life. You know, there's no way I can include everything that this man's done or the impact that he's had. And the best way I can think of it is kind of break it off into little sections. I want to start with his childhood. Dad grew up pretty much almost as an only child. He had three brothers and one sister. They were all quite a bit older than him. His oldest brother was 21 years old and was married when Dad was born. His youngest brother was 10 years old. So they were grown and gone by the time he finished growing up, so he was at home with Mom and Dad by himself. And Dad, or Grandpa, was fairly poor. He was a carpenter, a logger, a farmer, did whatever he could do to make a living. So Dad learned the value of hard work and family, and that carried on the rest of his life. He had a bicycle, was his only mode of transportation, being poor. And I've heard stories where he's actually rode that bicycle probably thousands of miles. He didn't learn to drive a car until he was 21. And I think his his brother Raymond loaned him his car to go so he could go see Mom. And I'm not sure he even knew how to drive it. That's brave. As a young adult, Dad joined the United States Air Force And I don't know how many times he's told the story about how much pride he had in wearing the drill instructor out. You know, drill instructors are supposed to get you in shape. So they'd go on these 5-10 mile runs, and Dad just thought it was funny. He'd been loading boxcars with 100-pound sacks at 3 a.m., cutting logs and pulpwood, and riding that bicycle endlessly. So when the drill instructor decided he was going to wear him out on the run, Dad, I think, kind of put the drill instructor to shame. He took a lot of pride in that. After boat camp, Dad was stationed in Louisiana, where he hitchhiked home, didn't have a car. He hitchhiked home to see Mom. You know, and soon after that, they were married, and, you know, Dad was 21, Mom was 14. You know, I think they put people in jail for that. Probably should have put him in jail. But they got started their life together. It's lasted 68 years. A good 68 years. His careers, he had several. I'm not even sure I can remember them all. Every time I look at this, I keep coming up with something else that I forgot. But Dad spent 20 years in the Air Force. He was a veteran, Korea, Vietnam. In those 20 years, we moved 21 times. And he was stationed in Louisiana, Jacksonville, Arkansas, South Africa, Oklahoma, North Dakota, Turkey. And he was schooled in missile and maintenance scheduling. And, you know, coming from his background, probably didn't have a really good education. The military did end up giving him probably a college degree. But he learned to type 60 words a minute on a manual typewriter. It was actually fun watching because he could turn. If you've ever worked a manual typewriter, he could do 60 minutes with two fingers. That's all he ever said. But some of his experiences and my memories, it's kind of a mixture here, guys, but they include things when we were on their base, they would have what they call blackouts, where, especially when we were overseas. You had to put tinfoil on your windows. You had to paint your headlights black. It was a blackout. And he would come home with briefcase handcuffed to his hands. You know, never talk about what he had or what it was, but I knew it was important. One of his favorite stories that he liked to tell, there was some kind of crisis going on, and his colonel had told him to get all these missiles ready for launch immediately at any point. Didn't have time to do it the normal way. So he's trying to figure out a way to get them ready. I don't understand missiles, but there was something to do with nitrogen, where he dumped 10,000 pounds of nitrogen on this farmer's field that was next to the missile silo. So then the government had paid this farmer. Don't tell me how much money he got paid for that. Dad was messing up his fields. Well, Dad had all our lives, he always had a part-time job. Never, ever had just one job. He always had two or three jobs. Well, he had a job there fixing flats at a service station. By the way, the guy that he was fixing flats with became a lifelong friend, and his daughter and son-in-law's here today. And that was, like, I think before I was born. But later on, while he was at that service station, he met that farmer and told the farmer he was the guy that dumped that nitrogen. And that Former thanked him. Said, man, I appreciate that. My fields have never been so green, and I got paid for it. Another good one that he had while he was there, they were supposed to transport a bunch of missiles to relocate. And he had probably a month or so to get this all coordinated, all the people, the equipment. Pretty big deal. He was responsible for it. Gets to the last moment, the trucks are there, everybody's there, permits, everything's done. He forgot that he didn't order a load. He had no way to get the missiles on the trucks. So typical of Dad, he saw that there was a bulldozer out there. So he gathered up chains, took that bulldozer, and loaded those missiles on the side of those tractor trailer rigs, just like he did at home, loading logs with a team of mules. But he got the missiles on that trailer. And that kind of prompted his colonel to tell him, say, Smith, sometimes I think you're a genius, and in the same minute, I think you're the biggest idiot I've ever seen. Guys, I just gave you the really clean version. I don't think that's what it really said. And typical of my dad, that was one of his proudest moments. He thought he had done something. But whatever Dad did, he managed to get the job done. After the Air Force, instead of just retired, he got out and worked for Missouri Pacific Railroad, which became Union Pacific Railroad, where he also retired. After many years, he would boast to me and his grandkids, if we ever took a day off work, he said, I worked the whole time at Union Pacific Railroad and never missed a day of work, ever. That's pretty amazing all in itself. You know, and typical of Dad, he couldn't just work for the railroad. Then he had to become the union representative. So then that took him on a bunch more adventures. One that really sticks out in my mind is where he went to negotiations in Chicago. And kind of shook him up a little bit because they assigned him a bunch of big guys with bats and guns to protect him as he was negotiating those things. You know, and after the railroad, his next venture was real estate. Started kind of a real estate broker, worked with Action Realty for many years here in Sheridan. And loved it because he was a people person, so he got to visit. Loved visiting. And typical of Dad, you know, just working for a real estate agent wasn't enough. So that tempted him into buying at two different times two parcels of land, equaling about 90 acres. Drags me into it too, and the other kids. And he's going to develop it and sell it off in lots. And then he also gets bunch of used house trailers. So we ended up with 10, 15 used house trailers that we had to level, hook up, do all that ourselves. Not going to pay anybody to do that. And we called that Smitty's Trailer Park. And I'm not sure he ever made any money with much of any of that, but he sure had fun. Because every tenant would come with a story that why they might not pay rent. And Dad was soft-hearted and believed it every time. Some of them were probably true, and those people needed help, and he was glad to do it. Other times, he probably was taken advantage of, and he didn't care. He just didn't care. He knew he was doing the right thing. Part-time jobs. Dad, like I said, always, all of our kids' lives had part-time jobs. During those times, it was always not even one. He had two or three most of the time. And those included Smith and Sons Cattle Farming, where we also cut baled hay for other people on halves. And what he'd do is he'd get up in the morning, work at the railroad, get off at 11 o'clock at night, get up in the morning, go cut hay at 6 o'clock in the morning. Get it baled maybe in the late in the afternoon if it was a hot day. And then call me or one of his son-in-laws and tell us we got, you know, 800 bales of hay we need to go haul and get to barn. Yeah, that was pretty good. He operated ICO Texaco for several years, and that's where we changed oil and fixed flats. Later, he operated the ICO One Stop for several years, and that's where he cooked pizzas and chicken. Quit fixing flats. And then there was Smitty Salvage, where he would go to the railroad and buy boxcars full of anything, whatever they wanted to sell. One of the biggest ones is he bought a two or three boxcar loads of loose potatoes. Loose potatoes. They had been too long, grocery stores wouldn't take them. So he builds a chute to go on the side of this boxcar. He gets us kids, mainly me, and he sticks me in this boxcar and I have to roll on my butt down these rotten potatoes, kick them into this ramp so he could load them at a 100-pound sack, and I think we sold them for $1 a piece, so they'd go quick. He'd liable to get tools from China. He didn't care. He'd figure out a way to sell them. He also liked to go to auctions, buy stuff, you know, looking for a good deal that he could resell. He loved doing it, mainly because he thought he might make some money, and he got to see 200 or 300 people that he could go talk to and know everybody by the time he left. Remember this one auction in particular that we went to, me and him went. We went there to buy a post hole digger, 3-point hookup post hole digger going back to the tractor. And everybody was bidding on that. Price was too high, we couldn't afford it. Couldn't afford a $600 post hole digger. But then they started auctioning off the whole farm. Dad thought that was a good deal. There was a banker at the auction. We went and talked to him, got approval for a loan. We bought the whole farm, 30 acres, 2 houses. Then we had to come home and tell Mama what we did. That was pretty interesting. The community service. Dad served on the Bethel Cemetery Board in the ICO community for I don't know how many years, several positions. He was instrumental in getting city water to the community of ICO or Cane Creek. He's the one that started it, talked to the water company, went and got signatures, did whatever it needed to get, make it happen. Then after he got us city water in our community, then for several years he was on the Sardis Association board, worked for them years. He was instrumental in getting natural gas to our community. He went around collecting signatures, got people signed up that wanted to take natural gas, and got that approved. After he did that, typical of Dad, he thought he might have saw a way to make a little money. So we went and bought a ditch witch. And then we were putting in gas lines for all the residents. You know, and I'm not sure how much he did, but he would hire kids or send me to Dad was also one of the founding members that started the Cane Creek Volunteer Fire Department when there was not one. He was very active in the Gideons, delivering Bibles to the jails and prisons, and he thoroughly loved doing that. For several years, he was extremely active in the Immanuel Baptist Church Heaters Food Bank, which is just right next door. And I know for a fact he made home deliveries to people that he knew needed help. They weren't going to ask for it, and they weren't going to come down here to the food bank to get it. But he'd load it up in his car, and he'd take it to them. And typical of Dad, I'm pretty sure he pulled in the driveway going about 80 or 90 miles an hour. That's the only way his Cadillac would run. And then this one was a good one. It was a Smitty's Taxi. I call it Smitty's Taxi Service. I don't know how. I guess these people loved him and they trusted him. But there were several widow women in our community that they would call Dad if they needed to go to the beauty shop, if they needed a doctor's appointment, or go to the grocery store, Dad would go get them. He'd take them. I got to tell this one, it was almost a business, so I probably shouldn't tell this one. But there was one particular lady that I've known all my life. Dad's probably known all her life. And she was in the bathtub at home by herself, and she couldn't get out. And she didn't want to call the fire department. She couldn't figure out who to call. She called Smith. He got her out of the bathtub. He thought that was funny. I thought it was pretty impressive that the lady loved and trusted him enough to call him when she didn't know who else to call. Yeah. Husband and father. When Dad married Mom, like I said, she was 14, and he cared and loved for her for 68 years. He took his responsibility very seriously, and he proceeded to spoil her best he could for as long as he could. He wanted to provide whatever she wanted and do whatever it needed to make her happy. Dad, you know, Dad loved to hear Mom play and sing the piano. And, you know, I did the video, if y'all were paying attention to the video and some of the music that's played today, a whole lot of that is Mom singing. And her one or two or three, however many. Mom was in several gospel groups. She did that all my life, all of our kids' life. And Dad, I think, was the number one stagehand. He would drag her around, take care of her, make sure she was on time and had everything she needed. But that's about all he was capable of. His singing maybe wasn't so good. But he did excel at the donkey song, if he didn't deserve the donkey song. As far as a husband, I've not seen better. And I think Mama would agree. He set the bar pretty high. Kind of left the men in our family with absolutely no hope of even getting close to his standards. And I think the girls in our family remind us of that very regularly. We are not like Dad. As a father and a grandfather, great-grandfather, he also set the bar high. He was fun, loving, wise, gentle, yet firm. Talked to us kids about God, prayer, value, family, hard work, truth, determination, perseverance. One of his favorite sayings was, "You're a smith and you can do anything." He's testing me today. As a man, Dad loved to have fun. Don't know that I've ever known anyone anybody that had any more fun than he did. It didn't matter where he was at, what he was doing, he was having fun. He had the ability to make work fun. 500 bales of hay in the field and he's cracking jokes. And he loved to agitate people. Oh yes, especially Mom, because she was an easy target. A little gullible, she fought for it. And her usual response to Dad when she got aggravated was, "Lois Smith, I'm gonna kill you dead." It wasn't just kill you, but kill you dead. And there is no telling how many times us kids have heard that all our lives. And Dad just laughing, sneaking off, getting out of her way, feeling like he had just really accomplished his goal. Dad also kind of had a weird sense of humor when it came to his friends. A typical greeting for him would be, "I hate your guts." Raise your hand if he's ever told you he hates your guts. Yeah. First time he ever said that to me, it shocked me to death. I'm not sure I ever got used to it, and I'll tell you, I am proud of the fact that I never repeated it. I didn't get that. One of the other things that we'll never remember, never forget, is his favorite way to wake us kids up all our life. He was up, cheerful, ready to go, early in the mornings. He'd tell you to get up one time. If you didn't get up, here it come. "Cheer up, my brother." He sang about like I am. He'd bellow it a little bit louder. And for me, now he wasn't quite as mean to the girls, but for me, he would grab my ankles, drag me out of bed and bounce me down the steps, singing that song. It happened many a time. And he thought that was fun. He sang this song, I think, in the video. And that was just within the last few weeks when he might not have even known who we were. But he knew that song. As a Christian, Dad's accepted Christ as a Savior at a young age. I'm not really sure yet. But I do know he made it a point to keep learning by reading his Bible, books, taking classes, always trying to keep improving his walk with the Lord. Dad was teaching us about God and the way we should live our lives and how to treat other people and work in the community, in the church. He'd tell us what we needed to do, but he mainly just showed us by being a consistent example. And he left some mighty big footprints. probably one of his missions was to make sure Gary was miserable. And he did that for as long as he could. But out of all the hats Dad's worn in his life, maybe Christian is the one that he put first in his life. That's what helped him achieve and accomplish everything else. And in closing, guys, for me, Dad had an extraordinary life that was well-lived, full of love, laughter, and adventure. Because if you went with Daddy, it was an adventure. And I know he's hearing God say, "Job well done, my good and faithful servant."
He is somewhat responsible for me being the pastor here at Immanuel for the last 12 years. And I saw him, didn't know him, saw him at a revival meeting. He asked me if I'd be interested in becoming the pastor of this church. And I said, no, no, but thanks for giving me an opportunity to tell you no. And the next morning, I was at my home bush hogging, working outside, and somebody just kept blowing up my phone. And finally, I shut everything down and answered it, and it was LV. And for a solid hour, he talked to me about why I needed to come to Immanuel in Sheridan, Arkansas. Over the last 12 years, I've asked LV, how did you get my cell phone number? And he's never told me. I don't know how he got it, but he got it. And I was thinking, when Clay was talking a moment ago, LV and I talked about this day one time. And he told me, he said, preacher, whatever you do, don't let it be a sad occasion. And then he said, if there's anybody there that says, I owe money, he said, I probably do, so have Clay take care of it. So, Clay, be aware. That's all I can tell you, brothers. Just be aware. LV wore many hats. And it's just us here, so let's just talk visit for a while today. Among our deacons, we had this joke about LV, and he knew it. But if there was something that needed to be done that was a little questionable, a little shady, LV's your man. We just hear LV, you need to take care of this. LV knew how to get stuff done. Our food bank is a huge success in our community, and we reach the needs of a lot of people through our food bank. And it was the burden and the dream of one of our members who has since passed away. And LV was a part of that movement at the ground level, getting the food bank started. And they started not in this nice building, but they started in literally a closet. It was back in the old fellowship hall, and we walked in one Sunday, and there are sweet potatoes laying everywhere on the floor, at least knee-deep in sweet potatoes. Well, you know, that's okay. We understood. But after 2 weeks and they began to rot and to stink, it was hard to have Sunday school in that class because LV had used our class as a storage place for sweet potatoes. He knew how to get stuff done. He had a way of making you feel guilty if you needed to feel guilty. I'd been here maybe 2 weeks, and he came up one morning and sat in my office, and we drank coffee and visited, had a wonderful, wonderful visit. And he got to the door and turned around and looked at me. I'm sitting behind my desk, and he said, all right, preacher, I hate your guts. And he walked out. I went to Miss Gale, our secretary, and said, this guy just told me he hated my guts and he don't even know me. She said, oh, that means he likes you. Oh, okay. It's a little weird, but okay. But I can tell you, if he never told you that, it's because he didn't like you. He loved when he was able to come to church. He shook a lot of hands and hugged a lot of necks. And he was very strategic with this. He would wait until the husband was there, and then he would say to the wife, come here and let me give you a hug. You need to be in the arms of a real man. That was L.V. Smith. He had many seasons of life, but the season that I want to talk to you about was about his life in the military. I just want to remind you today that old soldiers never die. They just go to heaven. And when we think about being a soldier, the Bible has a word about it. In fact, there are many different metaphors that are used in the Bible to describe the Christian life. One of them, the Bible says that it is a race. In Hebrews chapter 12 and verse 1, there the Bible says that we are to run patiently. We are to run with our eyes focused on Jesus. In 1 Corinthians chapter 9, Paul talked about the Christian life as a race, and he said that we got to run according to the rules. We've got to run so as to win. The Bible also uses the farmer as a metaphor for the life of a Christian. And he says that if we sow, we are going to reap. It also says that as farmers, we are to be patient as unto the coming of the Lord. And then it says, consider the husbandman, consider the farmer. But the Bible also uses the soldier as a metaphor for the Christian life, implying to us that in the Christian life, oftentimes it is a struggle. It is a battle. It is a battle from within. It is a battle from without. Well, you know, Clay has shared with you, and if you ULV, you already know that he spent much of his life, 20 years of his life, in the military. And he took great pride in the fact that he had served his country, and rightfully so. I mean, think about it. A person who is committed to freedom, committed to country, and they put 20 years of their life on hold so that you and I can do what we enjoy doing, so that we can live in a land of freedom. And so just briefly today, I want to talk to you about what a soldier is, a real soldier. Well, first of all, he performs faithfully. And LV was faithful. He was faithful to his family. He did all that he could to meet the needs of Miss Pauline and his children. He sacrificed his own wants, his own needs, so that they could have theirs. He followed them. He supported them. He did whatever he could to make sure that his family was content and had exactly what they needed. I am amazed that LV and Pauline were married for 68 years. You don't hear that anymore. Now, I did tell Miss Pauline after I got to know him, I was visiting him one day when they were living in Ico, and he was harassing her a little bit. And I looked at her and I said, Pauline, if you had knocked him in the head when y'all got married, you'd already be out of prison on good behavior. But you know why they were married for 68 years? Because divorce wasn't an option to them. Because they took the bad with the good. And the good outweighed the bad, didn't it? A lot of good years. His daughters, no doubt, when problems would arise, they would call their dad. His son viewed his father as his hero. And the one he sought after when advice was needed. He was faithful to his family, but he was also faithful to his church. You can count on him. If he told you he was going to do something, he was going to do it. Now, it might not have been the time he wanted it to be done and the way he wanted it to be done, but it was going to be done. In other words, he was trustworthy. I think about today that there are people who want to attend church but can't, like LV and Pauline over the last year or so. And then I think about those who can but won't. It's disturbing. But LV was committed, connected to his spiritual life. Not only was it his church, but also the Gideon ministry. Every year he made sure that the Gideons came to our church and that we received an offering from them. Now, LV started challenging our deacons and me as well to buy a case of Bibles when the Gideons came. And the first time, I didn't ask how much. I just said, well, sure, if they're doing it, I can do it. But he loved to share the Word of God because LV believed this about the Bible, that it is the power of God unto salvation. And the more people who have a copy of the Bible, the more people will know the gospel and have an opportunity to be saved. And of course, LV was faithful to his country. For that one season of his life, for 20 years, he put his own wants, his own desires aside to serve his country. And one of the reasons why was because LV realized that there were men before him who had served so that he could enjoy the life he had. And he served for you, his family. And he served for you, his friends, that we would know what freedom is all about. A real soldier also pursues fearlessly. Now, LV, he may have been bigger when he was younger, but he really wasn't a big man compared to me anyway and some other people. He really wasn't that big a man, but he was a man of great courage. I would think of LV and I would think of that saying, you know, it's not the size of the dog in the fight, it's the size of the heart of the dog that's in the fight. That's the way LV was. He didn't back up from anything. He persevered. He overcame. He adapted. Where did this courage come from? And here's the good part. Courage doesn't come from the size of a man. Courage comes from the Lord. Paul told Timothy, who was struggling on one occasion with some confidence and courage, and Paul said to him, look, God has not given us the spirit of fear. He's given us a spirit of sound mind, of love, and of power. That's where LV received his courage. And even the last moments of his life here on earth, there was no fear. Because LV recognized the truth that for the child of God, death is just a shadow, and a shadow can't hurt you. He also recognized that he was walking through Death's Valley, but he also realized that he wasn't walking alone. I've made this statement to our church on many occasions, and I cannot explain it. I do not understand it myself, but I believe it with all of my heart. That when it comes time for the child of God to die, God always provides dying grace. And LV received that. So you see, death, his passing, is sad for us. Even though he lived a long and fruitful life, it's still painful to be here today. But I want to tell you, it was a glorious moment for L.V. Smith. The day the angels came from heaven, unseen, nobody saw them. But nevertheless, they came. They left his body, but they took his sweet spirit, and they escorted it into the presence of God. And when he stood before the Lord, I think the conversation may have went like this. Old soldier, welcome home. You can take your sword off and you can hang it on the shimmering walls of glory, because you won't need that sword anymore. Because where you are, there is peace. There is no war, just love. There is no battles. They've already been won. You're home. You're finally home. While it's hard for us, it's sad. It was glorious for him. I used to love to call on him to pray because he had a way with words. But what was so impressive about the way he prayed is what you felt when he prayed. It was sincere. It was coming from his heart. And it was moving. When I first came here, I would call him occasionally and say, LV, I need you to pray for me. And we would talk about it, and he said, all right, preacher, I'm going to pray. And I'd imagine him, that little truck driving down the road, praying for his pastor. And you know what? Things just worked out. I think God heard him when he prayed. I'm glad that he was a prayer warrior for me. Tonight, you and I will go to sleep, and we will do so without fear. Without fear of our enemies invading our country. And we will be able to do so because of men like L.V. Smith, who sat on a wall so that we could sleep under a blanket of freedom without fear. But there is a greater freedom than political freedom. And it's freedom in Christ Jesus. LV recognized that as a young boy in the Methodist Church and the ICO community. Placed his faith in Jesus Christ and was saved. not because he was in a Methodist church or a Baptist church. You see, his faith was not in either one of those institutions. His faith was in Jesus Christ, and it never wavered after that. You can have that freedom today, the same freedom that he did. You see, LV enjoyed life. He wasn't concerned about the future because it had already been taken care of as a young boy. We can enjoy that same freedom ourselves today. And so the urgency of the hour is this, that if you've never called upon the Lord for eternal life, do so before it's too late. Would you bow with me as we pray? Our Father in heaven, we come before you and we thank you for the life of L.V. Smith. God, we know what you know, that he was not perfect. But in spite of his sin nature, we loved him. We're thankful for him. And Father, we thank you for what he has done and what he has meant to this church, to our community. And Father, we thank you for the man that he was. Thank you that he loved his calling the way that he did, that he raised his children in the manner in which he did. Father, we pray that you'd give us more men like L.P. Smith. And Father, we want to ask you now to, through your Holy Spirit, to minister to this family. We pray, Lord, that they would discover that you are the God of all comfort, the Father of all mercies. And Father, we pray that you would give them fond memories of their loved ones. May they be able to look back in the past and smile and laugh and cry. Minister to them. And Father, we pray, it's our heart's desire that you've been pleased with this service today. And it's in Jesus' name we pray.
And traveling of faith to one.
Understand. Yeah, follow him, Billy. Do what he says.
Yeah, that's, that'll be the best way. Big step right here.
Good.
Good. Big step. Big step. One on the right, one on the left, and one horn.
Brent,
which is the best way for us to go around, okay?
Thank you.
flag as a symbol of our appreciation for your loved one's honorable and faithful service.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah. In honor of your loved one, man. Biggest condolences.
On behalf of the Patriot Guard, thank you for allowing us to be here and for this service. On behalf of the great nation, great America, and the Patriot Guard, please accept our sincere prayers for your office. May your pain be tempered by the knowledge that that's the service of the U.S. Air Force is approved.
That is found in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4. And now, dear brothers,
we ask to conclude the service today, and I really, every day he could. Clay, I was telling him last night you weren't over there, but he would always open up just about every week, and he would say, now, those of you who aren't in the funeral business, it's just standard, and he'd say, now, how many do you have out there right now? And I would say, well, I've got, he'd say, well, Clay has. He didn't care. He just wanted to tell me what y'all were doing. Some passed away and some moved on. So the generation that knew about I Hate Your Guts was dwindling down. And so we made a competition every Sunday or every time we'd run into each other of who would be the first to approach the other and sneak up on them. And I don't know how he always won, but he always won. And I thought it was cute in the beginning, but then I realized what he was doing. He would always make sure there was somebody that was younger church member, newer church member, someone that didn't know. And he would sneak up behind me, and he would always, but I never regretted a minute with him. I enjoyed it. He told me when I was to be ordained as a deacon, and I'll never forget these words of advice, and you feel free to use them yourself. He said, as far as being a deacon, but you can apply this to your life, he said, you've got to be thick-skinned or find somebody else to blame it on. Not exactly something you want to embroider and put on your wall, but that was his advice, and I'll never forget it. I love this man.
Yes.
I loved his influence. I loved his counsel. He's one of those people that when I come in a room, other people go the other way. When he came in a room, you'd go towards him because you wanted to hear him. You wanted to be around him, and he wanted to be around you. And all I want to share with you is just a little reading, just for a couple of minutes. I know everybody's hungry, and he would say, hush, and let's go eat. I'm sure that's what he would say, but I want you to hear this, because he was so proud. I'll never forget him wearing that Air Force uniform to church, and how proud he was wearing it. All those years later, he was still proud wearing it, because he believed in God and country. And this is about a veteran. He is a man who looks the world in the eye. He's a man who feels an extra heart tug when a flag goes by. He's a man who steps a little faster when he hears the beat of a military band. He is a veteran. He comes in all assorted sizes and shapes. He's a big man. He's a small man. He's a short man. He's a tall man. He's the doughboy of World War I, the GI of World War II. He's the man who has seen Korean skies, fought the cold and uneasy Battle of Berlin, and brave the uneasy booby traps of Vietnam. He is a veteran. He is a sailor, a soldier, a marine. He is a flyer, a Seabee, a Coast Guard. He is artillery, infantry, medic, aviation, machinist, armor, and ordnance. He is a veteran. He has the quiet dignity of a man who knows the price of freedom. He has the clear eyes of a man who respects himself. He is courage living on Main Street. He is patriotism mowing the lawn on Saturday afternoon. He is good citizenship with a smile on his face. He is a veteran. He is a Republican, Democrat, Independent. He is a mechanic, farmer, and banker. He is a Catholic, Protestant, a Jew. He is rich and poor and in between. He is a veteran. He is a man who loves peace because he knows the price tag of war. He's a member of history's most exclusive fraternity. He is a veteran. He likes the majesty of America's mountains, the tranquility of America's valleys. He likes the bustle of America's cities and the friendliness of America's main streets. He likes the sound of America's children playing on America's playgrounds. He likes to see flag go by. He feels sad when he hears the sound of a bugler playing taps. He is a citizen soldier, peacetime leader. He is the first volunteer in a time of trouble and the last to come home. He is a veteran. He is proud of his American past, alert to his American present, confident of America's future. He likes the legends of America's greats, the Washingtons, the Jeffersons, the Lincolns, the Roosevelts, the Robert E. Lees, the Stonewall Jacksons, the Pattons, the Eisenhowers, the MacArthurs, and all the patriots who marched through American history books. He's been at Valley Forge, charged the hill at Gettysburg, stormed the sand at Guadalcanal, swarmed ashore at Omaha Beach, advanced on Pork Chop Hill, and fought in the bunker complex in Southeast Asia and the Mekong Delta. He parachuted into Grenada. He stood watch in Beirut. He fought the streets of Panama and served in the Middle East in support of Operation Desert Shield and fought in Desert Storm and Iraq and in the mountains of Afghanistan. He is a veteran. In the very rear of his secret heart, there's always a tinge of sorrow, a souvenir of sadness for lost and departed comrades. No matter how gray his temples grow or how many inches to his middle-aged waist, he always walks with distinct pride that isn't given to a lesser man. He's America's veteran with an honorable discharge. He is democracy with a good conduct medal lost in the darkness of his keepsake box. He is freedom with a purple heart. He is a first-class fighting man with a quiet walk and a sentimental grin. He is America's most honorable citizen. My buddy L.V. Smith was and is a veteran. Let's pray. Father God, as we come here today, Lord, we come bent but not broken. Heavy hearts but not hearts of despair, because we know. We know that He knew. And we know that God's word says for the child of God to be absent from the bodies, to be present with you. And we believe that. And He did too. Father God, we know that He's home today. We know that He's whole today. We know that He's well today. And we know, Father, we know that He's with you today. Father God, we just pray with that group of people that just entered heaven, Lord, that you would just call his name. He's talking to somebody, but just call his name.
Yes.
And bring him over there. And just hold your arm around him and point down to this little plot of ground in Cane Creek, Arkansas. And tell him he did a good job. And tell him we'll be okay. We'll take care of Miss Pauly. And tell him, Lord, please tell him that because of his Christian influence, many will see him that wouldn't have seen him otherwise. And all of us will see him soon. Father God, we thank you for being who you are. And we thank you for L.V. Smith being yours, your son, your child. And we celebrate his life, his legacy, and his love today. And we pray this in the precious name of Jesus, and all God's people say.
Amen.
The Smith family
funeral homes. I'd like to thank each of you for being here. Thank our employees who we also consider as part of the Smith family. And I had a man say to me today when I introduced him, introduced myself to him, he went, "Oh no, another Smith." You know, what could I say? Brother Copeland?
Yes, sir.
Brother Walton, thank you. Patriot Guard, thank you. United States Air Force Honor Guard, thank you.
Yeah.
So we so appreciate you all being here. But wait, we've got one more thing. Audrey, Penny, Kathy, you gonna come up here?
And this does conclude our service. So.